Greetings. This is part three in a series to teach those who call themselves Muslims what the Trinity is. Under part two, a poster began an interesting conversation. I think they use Islamic phrasing and cite various scriptures which appear to support the position of God is one alone. Test your discerner and see if you can understand what I mean. Here is his original post. Deuteronomy 4:35, Deuteronomy 32:39, 2 Samuel 7:22, 1 Kings 8:60, Isaiah 37:20, God is one, he is alone. 1 Corinthians 8:4. He begins with a list of scripture references, six of them in fact. I'll go through each one later. God is one alone. Notice the usage of God is one alone. God is one alone is a phrase used by Quranic thinkers, meaning their mind has been shaped by the Quran. The phrase God is one alone does not appear in the Bible. Now Christians, do your research. Be a Berean. Do a search and look for the exact phrase God is one alone. Let me know if you find it. Which translation, which book, chapter, and verse? Honestly, do not accept what I say without doing your own research to confirm it. Remember, there are no Bereans in Islam. And I'm going to go out on a limb here. No Christian should ever describe God as one alone. When you use it, you have begun to accept the Islamic definition of Almighty God. Remember, I began this video with test your discerner. So he continued, but yet in three persons, but still one God, the Bible teaches pure and strict monotheism. Again, the phrase pure and strict monotheism is an interesting phrase to use. Islam tries to claim it is pure and strict monotheism. I generally only see it used by a Christian when they are attempting to talk to a Mohammedan to make the claim that Christians are not polytheists, as the Quran accuses. So it is possible this poster misunderstands the video. I certainly allow that possibility. You make it sound like the Trinity is polytheism. If you've watched the part 2 video, let me know if you think it makes the Trinity sound like polytheism. So after this first message, I was still not judging or committing to my leaning. So I replied, the three persons or forms or identities in the Trinity are united as one because God describes himself as Echad. I'm not sure why you think the Trinity sounds like polytheism unless you think three persons means three gods, because a person is an individual. This is one issue I have using the word persons. I'm not saying it sounds like polytheism, but in the vid you make it sound like it is. Three persons, one God, showing himself in three ways, that's the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, are all God, but only one God and one God alone. At this point, I'm willing to consider linguistic confusion being a major contributor. Then I am sorry you misunderstood the video, my friend. If you can point to the minute and seconds where you think I misstated something, please let me know. Making edits is not impossible. 312 to 347. When you talk about God as one united, that is false. And show it to me from the Bible where it says that God is one united. He is one alone, three persons, or him showing himself to us in three ways, but still, as in Genesis and the rest of the Old Testament, God is one. He the only God, he alone, in the New we see more of him. I think in the New Testament we see more of him. He is three in one, or one in three. The Trinity is strict monotheism, and God is alone, but yet he a Trinity. So let us look back at 312 to 347.
Meanings. These include the number one and also the implication of united. The usage of the word echad is another ambiguity that God has included in his description of himself. If Almighty God wished to be absolutely clear and indicate singular numerical one alone, the proper Hebrew word to use is yachid. This is yet another straw on the back of the camel of one alone.
Perhaps the issue here is that I did not lay out the definition of echad clearly enough from Strong's Concordance. Go to biblos.com, look up Deuteronomy 6:4. You'll see something like this in the middle of the page. Notice that in these 13 translations of the Hebrew word echad, they all use the word one with no clarification. But here in the New Living Translation, the word alone was chosen. The choice of the word one or alone really does depend on the translator's understanding and selection. But praise God, we have the original Hebrew to go back to. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Shema Yisrael, Yahweh Eloheinu, Yahweh Echad. Here's the word Echad that is translated one. It's Strong's reference number 259. So if you go to the Strong site, this is the reference. Let's look at the many definitions and uses of echad. The most common usage is one, 586 times. The second most common usage is each, 48 times. That is an interesting meaning because each generally applies to individuals in a set or a group, a plurality. The third most common usage is first, 38 times. That is also interesting given first is a comparison in a group of more than one. That is also interesting given the Quran in Surah 573 says, "Say not God is first of three." The fourth most common usage is other, 27 times. Again, a fascinating meaning which only makes sense when more than one is being examined. Other does not even apply to the first or most obvious. It means the alternative to the antecedent. The fifth most common usage is same, 25 times. It is used many times expressing a portion of a number. And echad carries these definitions that imply plurality. Altogether, another, any, a piece, few, numbered, one and on another, one and the other, one to another, other, same, some, together, uniformly, unison, and united. Compare that with the definition of the Hebrew word yachid. The base definition is only, only one, or solitary. Look how simple this word is. Lonely, one and child, only, or only son. Look again how many definitions of echad imply plurality. The point I made in part two and did not support as well as I just have is that God had a choice. God had a choice to use the word echad or yachid. The word yachid would be simple and it would mean one only or one alone, solitary. No hint of plurality. But God, when he described himself, chose the word that carried many implications of plurality. I want you to notice in Mark 12:29, Jesus recites the Shema. The most important one, answered Jesus, is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. That gives us a possible way to cross-check the Greek word used to represent the Shema. Going to Biblos.com, Mark 12:29, notice the cross-reference points you back to Deuteronomy 6:4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And in Psalms 86:10, the phrase, You alone are God. This phrase, You alone are God, is evidence Christianity is monotheistic. Christians do believe there is one God, and we believe God's revelation of himself reveals three manifestations, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. In this context, saying you is the same as saying you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, are God. But let's look at the Greek word used by Jesus, here translated as one, or one Lord, or only Lord. The word used is eis, E-I-S, and I may be butchering the pronunciation. The Greek word number is 1520. If we look it up in Strong's Concordance, again let's look at the many definitions and uses of the word. The most common usage is one, 282 times. The second most common usage is first, 9 times. That is also interesting given first is a comparison in a group of more than one. The third most common usage is one thing, 5 times. The fourth most common usage is alone, 3 times. And including alone does not change the usage of an ambiguous term, a word that allows for plurality. And the above definitions all allow for plurality, agreement, alike, common, first, individual, another, someone, and unity. So we can see that the choice of the words by God choosing Echad and Jesus choosing Chais includes the ambiguity of plurality in the revelation of God's nature. I hope this somewhat exhausting look at Echad helps you understand this point of beginning to grasp God's revealing His plural nature, the Trinity. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I said I would go through these 6 verses cited. I will if requested to do so. Otherwise, that task will remain in the queue as free time allows.